All right, if everyone could please take your seats, we're going to go ahead and get started with our next speaker. Thank you. So our next speaker is Caroline Cyr. Caroline recently graduated from the University of Dallas with a bachelor's degree in politics with a concentration in legal studies. She currently serves as program officer for the Claire Booth Luce Center for Conservative Women, where she interned last summer. During her years as a college student at UD, Caroline served as a leader in student government and organized a campus lecture featuring Liz Wheeler, who spoke on the topic of authentically living conservatism. She was also involved with a local political philosophy group, the Dallas Forum on Law, Politics, and Culture. Caroline is originally from St. Louis, Missouri, and is the oldest of eight children. Please join me in welcoming Caroline Cyr to the stage.
Well, hello, everyone. Good afternoon. It's great to see all of you here. It is such a pleasure to be back at the AF headquarters here in Reston. As Nick said, my name is Caroline Cyr, and I am currently the program officer at the Claire Booth Luce Center for Conservative Women. For those of you unfamiliar with the Claire Booth Luce Center, our mission is to promote leading conservative women of today and to raise up the next generation of female conservative leaders. If you would like to chat more about our mission, feel free to chat with me after this, or visit our website, cblwomen.org. As a recent college graduate, I thought that I would share with you some thoughts about the, at times, daunting prospect of navigating college as a conservative. But first, I wanted to lend a little bit of pre-college advice. As high schoolers, you might be thinking about your college decision, and if you aren't, you will before you know it. When it comes to thinking about where to go to college, there's one thing that you should remember. There is not one perfect school for everyone. Some of you may want to go to a conservative school that fosters the ideas and philosophy that you believe in. This was the path that I chose, but it's not for everyone. I knew that I needed 4 years to learn, grow, and deepen my conservative beliefs before heading out into the real world. But some of you won't need to do this. Many of you, I'm sure, feel ready to take on whatever a leftist college or a leftist professor will have to throw at you. When it comes to making the college decision, it really is all about knowing yourself, knowing your abilities, and being realistically humble about what environment you will thrive in. So, look around, investigate a wide variety of opportunities, and focus on choosing the school that will best form you as a young adult. Once you're in college, you'll find yourself with more freedom, more opportunities, and less rules. With this comes a lot of potential to explore new interests, get more involved on campus, and become more well-rounded as an individual. Here's the tricky part, one that many ignore all too easily. The key to actually living successfully throughout your college years, which is something that it is even more important for your future conservative leaders like yourselves to do, can be summed up in a word: order. Hear me out. Giving your agenda, your academics, and your social life a rhythmic order will make everything easier. As someone who did not learn this lesson until her junior year at the University of Dallas, believe me, once you get your priorities straight, your weekly or daily schedule aligned, and your free time its proper place, you will have the opportunity to do more than you ever thought you'd be able to. Something as simple as taking the time to think through what you need to accomplish on a certain day, be it academically, socially, or otherwise, will help you parse out how much free time you have. And finding good interests will help fill in those free time gaps. For example, my junior year of college, I was put in isolation due to COVID-19 for 5 days. As some of you might know, in the January and February of 2021, there was a big ice storm in Texas, and so we didn't even have online classes. So I was stuck in an isolation room Not feeling sick at all, but you know how the COVID lockdowns are, with nothing to do for 5 days. So I decided to set my sights on gaining an internship in the Washington, D.C. area. I was a politics major, but I hadn't taken a super vested interest in politics in terms of my career and college decisions yet. But that all changed when I was put in isolation and given more time. So I started looking at a variety of conservative organizations, trying to see which one I would be the best fit for. I applied to a lot. Some of them panned out, a lot of them did not, but the good ones did, and that's what's important. Ultimately, I chose the Claire Booth Luce Center, as Nick had already mentioned, and because I had had this newfound commitment to gain an internship in the DC area, I decided that it was time that I start organizing my life a little bit better. The interview and application process for CBL was similar to many other conservative organizations. It's a little bit lengthy. It's something that does take time, but it's very, very valuable. And you really start to figure out why you want to be at the organization you're applying to. It's wonderful. So I applied, I got the internship. I had a great, great summer as a CBL intern. And then I came back to the University of Dallas in the fall. And I thought to myself, well, senior year, I wouldn't start applying for jobs until at least Christmas break, but I have the fall and I have all this free time. So what am I going to do with it? So I hadn't ever really been much involved in my campus's student leadership. I always thought that was for people who had all the time and all the energy in the world, and I was not one of those people. But my senior year at the University of Dallas, I chose to become a class senator and chair of a student government committee. This was a step that I never would have taken if I hadn't started to plan out my time well and then learned that I had so much more time to give to my school. This new role on student government then enabled me to get to know a wider variety of my amazing University of Dallas peers than I had ever met before in the previous 3 years. I developed new relationships that I would not otherwise have developed. Not only that, but through the connections I built on SG, particularly with our Dean of Students, as well as thanks to my internship with the Claire Booth Luce Center, I was able to welcome Liz Wheeler of the Liz Wheeler Show for a lecture this past April. This was because I realized that when you give order to your time, you will find that you have more of it. Another important thing that comes with ordering your time well is giving yourself a chance to slow down. This is a hard lesson, and God knows I'm not perfect at it, but if you can slow down, take a deep breath, and set aside a few minutes of visual and mental silence a day to process your thoughts, you'll feel far more at peace and therefore more prepared to take on whatever the day throws at you. Brilliant ideas or insights that would have never had the ability to work their way through the noise of Spotify playlists or classroom lectures will come to mind in these silent moments. But living order doesn't end with time management. Another thing I've learned over the past few years, mostly from watching my friends, unfortunately, go through this, is that when you get to college, you must never, ever compromise on your housing situation. If your housing, whether it be due to a bad dorm or an inconsiderate roommate, is preventing you from thriving on campus, do your best to change it. When your own living situation is in order and you know that you have a clean, quiet place to return to after a long night of studying, yes, with your bed made and all, you will be able to accomplish much, much more throughout the entire day. If a place as necessary and basic as your dorm is not in the right order, no other part of your life will be. The same goes for every other facet of your personal life. Conducting yourself well, dressing nicely, and even ensuring that you get enough sleep are all necessary to developing good habits and expectations for yourself. And this will help you set yourself up for success post-grad. As conservatives, we need to ensure that we maintain effectiveness and credibility in the way we carry ourselves, both in private and public life. Don't ever give the left the opportunity to bad name you for something that you can avoid. In academia, a good reputation is all the more difficult to maintain as a conservative, but because of that, it's all the more important. At a seminar last summer, I heard a piece of advice that I will never forget. Our speaker said, "Every moment is a hot mic moment." This is an idea that has since been proven true to me on countless occasions. You never know who is listening. You never know who's in earshot. You never know who is watching. And you certainly never want to say something about another person that you would not want to get back to them. This is especially true in the really quite small town of Washington, D.C. Someone who you speak unkindly about during a summer internship program next summer could be the person that you need to connect you with a future employer in a couple years. Or perhaps the head of another, maybe competing conservative club on campus that you don't necessarily like will be the club that you need to ask to co-sponsor a big speaker for a lecture. Whatever the case, it is always better to create unity in the conservative movement rather than division. And if you want to master this key part of networking and thriving in DC, you must begin to develop this discretionary skill set during your college years. When thinking about this, always keep in mind former President Reagan's 11th commandment: "Thou shalt not speak ill of any Republican." The same goes for any and all professional relationships that you hope to develop, both in and out of college. When it comes to more general areas of conduct and dress and order, think of the many great conservatives we see on TV, online, and on Capitol Hill. Great ladies such as Liz Wheeler and Dana Perino are excellent dressers. They act with a sense of propriety and confidence, and they are always well-read and well-prepared. For the men, conservative men such as former Vice President Pence and Ben Shapiro always maintain a clean-cut and gentlemanly look. This can only serve to help you in any future career. In college, the temptation is always to dress comfortably, and sometimes too casually, for class. While the culture is different at every school, as a general rule, this is not a good idea. Don't forget that people are always looking. People are always paying attention. A lack of seriousness in dress misses the opportunity to showcase your ability to be well-prepared and put together. Whether trying to win over an argument in the classroom, during a lively discussion, or considering asking a professor for an important letter of recommendation, good comportment, composure, and dress can only serve to help. So back to what I said about timeliness. Now that you have all this extra time, what are you going to do with it? This is where prudence comes in. Prudence is given as either right reason in action or practical wisdom, depending on who you read. But in terms of prudence, and in terms of living your life in an orderly fashion, one of the most basic needs of any person, of any political animal, as Aristotle calls us, is friendship. So, firstly, with your extra time, you need to make some really good friends. Friends who may or may not agree with you on politics, but who are simply good for you and you for them. Friends who make you want to be a better person and who can positively influence you to do the same. Friendships take time and energy and effort to cultivate, especially in a college where you all may be on different class schedules. But building these strong friendships can help you grow in every way. Socially, personally, academically, and in your ability to think about the big political ideas. Don't underestimate the importance and the essential nature of friendship. Secondly, as a future conservative leader, as you all are, you ought to use the time you have to get more involved. Campuses, especially big ones, but even small ones like the one that I went to, often have at least a few conservative clubs for you to join. Alexander Hamilton Society and, as you know, Young Americans for Freedom are just a couple. Sometimes there may also be a club unique to your university. For example, during my junior and senior year of college, I was a member of the Dallas Forum on Law, Politics, and Culture. The forum hosted a wide variety of excellent programs this past year, from a two-day-long in-depth critical race theory seminar to lectures by speakers like Roger Severino and Mary Eberstadt. Smaller, more niche groups like the forum can be just as valuable as bigger ones, so be sure to keep an eye out for those on your college campus one day. And, of course, if there isn't a great conservative club or organization for you to join, you can start one. Big groups like College Republicans, Young Americans for Liberty, and Young Conservatives of Texas are often eager to open chapters on college campuses. When I chaired a committee on my university's student government, I was in charge of approving the constitutions of all newly founded student-led organizations. This past year alone, I ratified the constitutions for both a Young Conservatives of Texas chapter and a Young Americans for Liberty chapter. So that may not sound super impressive, it's two out of the entire school year, but at a school with only about 1,400 undergrads and at least three or four conservative clubs already, this was a pleasant surprise to me and my fellow conservative students. For those who choose to get involved, the conservative movement is always, always growing. And building off of the forum that I mentioned earlier, you could also start your very own conservative club, depending on the ethos of your school. Getting involved with clubs or student leadership opportunities can further enable you to find good friends by providing the opportunity for solid, open, and honest conversation. While all of your friends don't need to be politically conservative or even political at all, it is good to have those friends who you can talk to about the more traditional conservative values that you share. Club and organizational involvement thus provides not only the chance for activism experience and the great stories and resume credibility that come along with that, but also an opportunity to develop good friendships with like-minded conservatives. In tandem with increased activity in conservative clubs, you should also consider bringing a lecturer to your campus once you're in college. You can opt to do it either on behalf of your club or one sponsored by an outside group. This past April, thanks to the generous help of the Claire Booth Luce Center, I was able to host Liz Wheeler for a lecture on my university's campus. Ms. Wheeler spoke on how to authentically live conservatism. It was a lot of hard work, a lot of preparation, and ultimately a big time crunch to get it all done in time, but it was worth it. The lecture was very well received by all the students who attended, and they also got the chance to meet more one-on-one, a conservative icon they'd been a huge fan of. Me and the girls who worked on the lecture also got the chance to meet Mrs. Wheeler, her husband, and yes, Lady Baby. And yes, we did go out to dinner with them, and yes, it was pretty amazing. Not only was the lecture itself excellent and beneficial to all of the students who attended, myself included, but it also gave me the chance to work on planning and organizational skills. These are capabilities that I'm still very much developing, but that I've now been able to carry into my new position as program officer with CBL. In this position, I'm in charge of all of the Luce Center's programming. I now do everything from outreach to young ladies who are interested in hosting a Luce speaker on their campus, to heading our well-rounded and educational intern program, to planning our annual Woman of the Year calendar, which is very exciting. These are just a few things of the great things that we do here at the Luce Center, of which I've been a very grateful beneficiary over the past year. Organizations like the CBL Center are happy to help sponsor and host a Luce speaker on your college campus. Some of you, especially young women, on leftist college campuses might find it difficult to tap into a network of like-minded conservative women. Finding conservative peers can be hard enough, but finding good conservative female friends can sometimes be even harder, believe me. And hosting a lecture is a good way to meet young conservative women who would want to attend a lecture by a great conservative woman of today. Plus, hosting a lecture can really only serve to grow your planning, punctuality, and leadership skill set. So, planning your own life well enables you to plan other things well too. Planning other things well, like a lecture or event, with professionalism, attention to detail, and a consideration of the totality of the tasks at hand, will be an experience that you can carry into any future position. Thirdly, with your extra time, you are going to be able to, and you really, really ought to, use your newfound time to do what it is incumbent on each and every future conservative leader to do. You're going to develop and learn to defend your beliefs. For some of you, this will be a given. At too many big college campuses, the classroom has become not a place for the free exchange of ideas pointed towards objective truth. Rather, it's become a mire of ideological single-mindedness and a complete denial of all objective truth except for the objective truth that truth does not exist. Like, that makes sense. When bombarded daily by professors who broadcast that they find conservative ideals unthinkable and who call their confused students any variety of zany pronouns, it becomes obvious to many young conservative students, and rightly so, that the onus is on them to learn more and to better defend what they believe. But if you're a conservative going to a conservative school, like me, don't think you're off the hook. One of the great benefits of schools like my own and other schools with a great conservative student body and an excellent curriculum is that there is always a risk of falling into a rut. As I mentioned before, I was by no means the perfectly accomplished college student, and this did cause me to fall into a bit of complacency. It's really, really easy. Good schools can sometimes become echo chambers of conservative ideas, but like with anything, you need pushback and you need a challenge and if you want to grow and become better and be able to better defend your beliefs. It is so easy to know what you believe, but it is not half as easy to be able to articulate why you believe it, especially on a hostile campus or in a hostile real-world situation. You may be in a kind of conservative safe space at your small liberal arts college, but that won't last forever. The importance of knowing how to defend your beliefs with confidence and graciousness cannot be underestimated. Use that extra time you have to read, to learn, and to try to grow into a better and more developed thinker. Take advantage of your time in the conservative bubble, away from the torrents of leftist campuses, to build a sturdy foundation on which to lay your conservative philosophy. If you choose to take advantage of the chance you have, you will be much better prepared for the trials that await you post-grad. A great start towards growing your own knowledge and credibility is finding a topic you're passionate about and becoming an expert on it. Issues such as the ever-increasing empathy towards socialism, defending the pro-life movement, which is especially pertinent today, as you all know, and fighting for our civil liberties against ever-increasing governmental overreach are just a few examples of hot-button topics that reveal the intrinsic difference between the way that the right and the left understand politics and the end of government. Socialism is an especially important topic to be well read on. This is a CBL publication on socialism, and little pamphlets like this can be super, super quick and easy guides on how to have good talking points when the time to defend capitalism comes along. Loose Center President Michelle Easton says that every conservative should have at least 3 or 4 arguments against socialism. Throughout college and post-college, the temptation to think, why can't the government just forgive all the student loans I have and also pay for that super expensive healthcare, will only become stronger. So, understanding the economics, history, and philosophy behind socialism and social programs is a great way to defend American founding principles, and it is also a good way to think about to defend the good ideas of equality and justice and their true sense. But before intervening in every classroom discussion that has a leftist lean, or before staging a walkout at every leftist lecture on your campus, consider the aforementioned idea of prudence. For those who will one day be on leftist campuses, an important rule of thumb is that you pick your battles. Conservatives, especially on hostile campuses, need to be effective. We need to bring people closer to truth with a winsome spirit and good ideas. So, before you involve yourself, think to yourself, is it worth losing my audience or losing this friend, and thus losing much of my effectiveness and much of my sway by entering into this one particular classroom conversation? Or, if you're hosting a lecture for the first time, you need to ask yourself, is it worth it to have the speaker talk about the more controversial topic you're considering, or the one that will spark a more positive reaction and get better reach? But do save the more controversial one for later, because those are always fun. But, and this is important, when you do pick your battles, don't ever let fear or paranoia keep you from spreading your message. The left certainly doesn't, and the right can't either. When you need to, fight fire with fire. We are, as Star Parker recently noted at the CBL Intern Summit, in a fight for the soul of this nation. It is necessary for conservatives to be effective, to spread our ideas with grace, and to not compromise on our ideals. Those who are able to achieve this may even be able to convince non-political students of the truths of conservatism, or even convert leftists to the truths of conservatism. The conservative movement needs to grow and flourish. This must start on your future college campuses. Your confidence, know-how, and good understanding of conservative ideas can help bring more people into the conservative movement. And prudence will be your guide on how to achieve this. To conclude, remember the twofold importance of order and prudence. Order, to give you time and to open up opportunities, and prudence, to use that time well and to make the most of those opportunities, all while maintaining the utmost effectiveness and cultivating the conservative message well. Your college years really will be some of the best years of your life. Often, what you're able to accomplish in college will pay you back in droves in life post-graduation. So, once you get to college, don't waste those 4 years. Thank you.
At this time, we're going to be starting our Q&A session. So if you have questions, please make your way to the back of the room, and a staff member will guide you to the front of the mic. Thank you.
And whoever has the best question gets a free copy of our president's new book, How to Raise a Conservative Daughter.
You really put the pressure on right there. Okay. Well, my name is Daniela Thomas. I'm from California. I've been homeschooled my whole life. And I've always been super obsessed with organization. Not that I'm good at it, but I'm obsessed with it. But do you have any tips on how you would organize your schedule effectively in order to have extra time?
Yes, absolutely. So this may sound a little strange, but I'm actually not someone who uses an actual agenda. I have a journal, and every night before I go to bed, I sit down with a nice cup of tea, and I sketch out everything that I need to accomplish in the next day, socially, professionally, personally, all of it. And then I'm able to kind of write out and rationalize how I use my time. I try to think about how long will this take, will I have a gap in between these two things, and just how I can be the most efficient as possible. Essentially just setting aside time to write out that agenda. Use an agenda if it's helpful for you. I tend to not, but it's totally up to you. And then just, really make an effort to think through what you need to do and how you can best do it. And make sure to keep your priorities in right order. I know it's super easy to fall into focusing or only emphasizing one thing that you need to accomplish, but don't forget that your social obligations, your friendships, and taking care of yourself are very, very important facets of success in your professional and in your academic life as well. So thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Hello, my name is Ellie Severino. I'm from the DC area. And I was wondering how you would advise to develop our skills of defense, because I know, even though I'm in a mostly conservative school, the questions always get brought up, and I'm sometimes at a loss as to how to answer whether or not this is the right battle to choose. And I was wondering if you had any book recommendations or, you know, processes you suggest to be preparing yourself that when you get asked these tough questions, you know how best to answer.
Right. Okay. Very good. So definitely in terms of learning how to defend your beliefs, reading is a very, very important thing. You should keep up on current events. You should read books by the great conservative minds of today. I remember reading Michael Knowles's book, and that was really, really helpful to me. Ben Shapiro's books are also great, a wide variety of books on from today's great conservative thinkers. But then also because of my curriculum at college, I really focused on reading a lot of good books on political philosophy. And those sorts of books, like the older books, like The Law by Frederick Bastiat, or, I mean, even if you can find a good translation, Aristotle's Politics or Plato's Republic, honestly, it sounds daunting. It is not, I promise. Those are the books that really will help you get to the root of the end of government. And those are the books that will really help shape the foundation of your political philosophy. And then from there, conservatism kind of necessarily flows from like a good understanding of government. Keep up on the news, of course, on current events, Dobbs, all of it. Read books by good conservative minds of today, but also don't forget to read those books that focus on the bigger ideas in politics, because, I mean, like I said before, the difference between how the right and how the left understand politics is really a very fundamental thing. So make sure that you're also getting down to the fundamentals. And then, of course, when you're defending, just do it graciously. Do it in the most effective way you can by knowing your audience and knowing your argument very, very well. So when in doubt, just be gracious and be well-read.
Thank you.
Of course.
Hi, I'm Nathan Thomas from Blythe, California. And I was wondering, you talked about order and prudence. And in that first section, order, I'm talking about the entirety of order, but take, for example, cleaning your room. What is the better approach? Is it a better philosophy to go incrementally, a little bit every day, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, or is it the better approach to the sort of binge cleaning cycle, you know, where you let things get out of control and then binge it?
So I find that the best way that I've been able to live order is by doing the more gradual cleaning. Clean up after yourself as soon as you're done, whether it's cooking or getting ready or anything, so that you can always have a clean space to return to. Sometimes when you let things pile up, like anything in life, not just with cleaning, like if you let it pile up, it starts to weigh on your mind. And then even if you do eventually get it all done and get it all cleaned up, it's just not as good as if you had been kind of doing it as you go. So I'm definitely a do it as you go type of person, but that's a question that you would kind of have to think about and parse out for yourself using prudence. So
thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Hi, my name is Jaden. I'm from Midland, Texas. And my question for you is how to decide between going to more of a conservative school and a liberal school. And if you do decide to go to a more liberal school, how would you keep your beliefs in that and defend them against so forth?
So in terms of choosing between a conservative or a liberal school, it really is kind of about knowing yourself. Know what you want to major in. know what you want to be involved in, and have a basic idea of what you want your career to look like out of college. For example, I knew that I wanted to do politics, so I chose a school that I knew had a really, really good politics program. However, you could be prioritizing differently. For example, if you want to do something like architecture or just something in the medical field, you may find that it's more beneficial to your career to go to a more leftist school. So it really kind of depends. I would say a lot of it depends on your major, on what sorts of social clubs and organizations you want to get involved in. And then also just making the decision on what kind of campus environment you really, really thrive in best. So it's very much a personal decision. Like I said, there's no one perfect school for everyone. And as to defending your beliefs at a leftist campus, I can't speak for this so much in college, but actually I did go to a slightly leftist all-girls high school. And so in terms of kind of defending your beliefs at a campus like that, having those really, really solid friendships with friends who may or may not disagree with you politically, but who aren't willing to end your friendship over the fact that you might disagree with them on a policy issue or a political philosophy issue, those friendships are going to really be your foundation. So when you get to your more leftist college campus, if that's what you decide, just make sure to develop close and tightly knit friendships, friendships that will last you for the rest of your life. And then when the tough times come, you'll have kind of your friends to fall back on. And I know it sounds cliche, but it's cliche because it's true. So yeah, focus on finding those really, really good friends. And then of course, just staying informed, staying up to date, always learning, always growing, always trying to become a better conservative. And yeah.
Thank you.
Of course. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Abby Garland. I'm from Ohio. My question is, you work for a women's conservative organization.
Yes.
How is your organization and the way that they celebrate being a woman in politics different than the way that modern feminists and like radical feminists celebrate being, you know, like a woman in that way?
Okay, that is a very good question. So the work that we do in the environment that we foster at the Claire Booth Luce Center is very much one that is not aligned with like the modern feminist movement. We are all women who have kind of not neglected our home life or not neglected like the important, well-rounded things that women are normally tend to be more interested in as a whole. But we also feel this very deeply ingrained mission that women can go out, they can be in the world, and they can be politically involved. And that is a really, really positive thing. And when we look kind of to our mission, we focus a lot on looking at the great conservative women of the past as inspiration. Margaret Thatcher, Phyllis Schlafly, Claire Booth Luce herself, who, if you guys aren't familiar, Claire Booth Luce was a US representative and then a US ambassador. She also was a playwright, and she had a very prominent husband who founded Life magazine, Time magazine, etc. So all of the women at the Claire Booth Luce Center really try to live well-rounded lives. We all happen to be women of faith, which animates a lot of what we do. And we really focus on kind of not trying to separate ourselves from men because we don't like men, but simply because we recognize that there are intrinsic differences between men and women. Not intellectual differences, but there are important differences. And there are, of course, a lot of great organizations that are devoted to helping young conservatives thrive and grow, and who are dedicated to promoting the great conservative thinkers of today. But when our president, Michelle Easton, founded CBL, she saw a gap in organizations that were working to help young conservative women who did not align with the modern feminist agenda. So that is our mission.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Nino Palumbo. I'm from Washington, D.C. and go to the Heights School.
Oh,
So very good.
My question for you is, why do you think there has been a popularity of left or liberal ideas being shared and dominated in IV and elite colleges?
That is a big question. So I will say I don't have a full answer on that, but I think part of it, from what I understand, is that for years, conservatives kind of took academia for granted. I think that there just weren't enough good conservatives going to grad school, going and pursuing their PhDs. And so now we're feeling the effects of that with the professors. I do think that a lot of it does have to do with the professors and the administration, the administrations at these big schools maybe caving to pressure from professors or perhaps from donors on that sort of thing. So it's a really big question. I don't have a full answer for you, unfortunately. But what I can say is that if we're going to take back these leftist college campuses, the way that we are going to do that is by raising up the next generation of conservative leaders who will, you know, go to college and be witnesses to the conservative movement, but then also consider, I mean, going to grad school, pursuing your PhD, becoming the professor that you wish you had had in college. That is the real way that we are going to take back academia. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
We have time for one more question.
Hi, my name is Alice Nishimura. I'm from California. And I was wondering, do you think the money saved by going to an online college is worth the loss of potential networking opportunities presented if you go in person?
So that is a very good question. I would say the networking opportunities very much depends on what university you're going to. Sometimes the fact that you are an alum of that university is enough. But in terms of more general online versus in person, I think that there is a lot more to in person that is very, very valuable besides just the networking opportunities. For example, building good relationships with your professors, going to office hours, taking the time to really chat and kind of get involved with your fellow students on campus. For example, a big part of the culture at my university was that students will often be sitting out on this great big kind of public space called the mall. And you can often just sit down and with your friends and spark up a really, really good substantive conversation. Part of that also stems from like having a good curriculum at your school. But I would say with a view to networking, but also to building good relationships with your professors and really solid friendships that help you develop your ideas better, I think that in person is the way to go. But yeah, thank you. Alrighty, well, thank you so much for the opportunity to come and speak to you all, and I hope you have a great rest of your time at this awesome conference. Thank you.